Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 29th of April 2021. All right. As you know that these lectures are basically useful for those who are preparing for the civil services examination, which is conducted by the UPSC, as well as other government competitive examinations, right? And for that purpose, you should also study the national newspapers like Hindu, or you can also refer Indian Express. Okay, both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers. Apart from that, you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures, which are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. So you can subscribe the channel on the YouTube for getting these lectures, right? So let's begin with the lecture. Okay. So first news is regarding certain amendment which is done to the Government of National Territory of Delhi 1991. So that Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi Amendment Act 2021. Okay. So before we go into the detail of the today's news, let us understand first of all, this is the amendment which is done basically to the Government of National Territory of Delhi Act 1991. So it is also called the Amendment Act 2021. Because it has received, it has got the president assent, and now it has also been, you know, published on the gazette notification. So now the Ministry of Home Affairs, which is basically having the authority over, you know, issuing this gazette notification for the purpose of this amendment act, have been notified recently on the gazette notification, okay, and which is already deemed to be fact from April 27th of this month. Okay, so this act, which basically gave more powers to the lieutenant governor, right? So certain powers and the responsibilities, right, which are given more to the lieutenant governor. So first of all, this amendment act also provides certain restrictions on the power of legislative assembly of the Delhi. As you know, the Delhi is also union territory, which is also having its own legislative assembly, right? The Delhi also has got its own chief minister, right? As well as the Council of Ministers, along with your Legislative Assembly. Okay, now let us first understand the brief background about the National Capital Territory of Delhi. Then we'll move to what are the all restrictions that have been recently been imposed, right, on the powers side of the Legislative Assembly or the Council of Ministers, which is basically headed by, you know, your basically the Chief Minister of Delhi. Okay, so we'll first understand the powers which have been given to the Legislative Assembly. Okay, now first of all, you must understand that this Act of Amendment Act of 2021 gives more primacy to the Lieutenant Governor over the elected government in the city. So more primacy in terms of the more powers have been given to the Lieutenant Governor. Now, this act, as I already told you, is basically amend the Government of National Territory of Delhi Act 1991. Okay, so the main purpose is basically, as clarified by the Government of India, is to end the absence of any sort of a clarity that was not there, right, regarding, you know, some sort of a issues between the Lieutenant Governor as well as the Chief Minister of Delhi. So there were certain issues that on what matters the Chief Minister of the Council of Ministers should be consulted, and what should we go ahead with that if there is a conflict between the views of the Chief Minister and the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi. Okay, and as the Government of India also stated that it further defined the responsibility of elected government as well as the Lieutenant Governor in Delhi. Okay, so background of this issue, first of all, you must understand that the Delhi, it was basically in 1991, it was way back in 1991. Okay, when the Delhi was given a fully elected legislative assembly at that point of the time, right? And that was basically a responsible government, just like a normal legislative assembly. Okay, and the 69th Constitutional Amendment Act in 1991 conferred, right, the Union Territory of Delhi a special status, right? So with this 69th Constitutional Amendment Act 1991, a territory of Delhi or the Union Territory of Delhi have been given a special status. Okay, and now henceforth it has been redesigned as the National Capital Territory of Delhi, right? And under this act, 69th Constitutional Amendment Act, right? The design, the administrator of the Delhi would be designed as the lieutenant governor. Lieutenant governor, not simple governor, but a lieutenant governor. Okay. So in the special case, right, the special constitutional status have been provided to the National Capital Territory of Delhi. So first of all, the 1991 Act provide the fully elected assembly. That means it has the assembly which is fully elected by the people of Delhi by the process called universal adult franchise, and it has got also the Union Council of Ministers. So it has got the powers of, you know, the legislature. So it can legislate on all matters which are there in the state list, just like other state. Okay, as well as it can also legislate on the concurrent list. But there was certain problems, right? The problems were basically the difference between the lieutenant governor, which is basically, you know, the administrative head, right, as well as the council of minister of any matter, right? So what should be there if there is a difference between them? So the act provide that if there is a difference, right, the lieutenant governor should refer the matter to the president, and then, you know, then lieutenant governor can take any action on that matter as he deems appropriate, right? So according to the matter which have been revert back from the president. So that was the case. That was first time, you know, it was found very difficult that what should we do, right, if there is a pending such decision, right, not coming on the time from the president of India at that point of the time. Okay. And even the constitutional bench of Supreme Court basically held that the government does not have to seek the concurrence of lieutenant governor on certain decisions, on decisions, right? And if there is any difference between the government of Delhi as well as the lieutenant governor, then that should be resolved keeping in view the constitutional primacy of the representative government, right? So the constitutional bench basically gave more primacy to the legislative body, or to the basically the representative government. And definitely, you know, the state government is under constant threat from the lieutenant governor power. Definitely, because now the union government also provided more power to the lieutenant governor in that respect. Okay, so this was a brief background for your understanding. Okay, now let us understand what are the powers which have been changed by this 2021 Amendment Act. So first of all, the restrictions on the law which is passed by the assembly, which have also been made. So bill basically provide that government refer to any law which is made by the legislative assembly will implied as lieutenant governor. That means now, henceforth, the government of, you know, the Delhi will be called as, you know, the lieutenant governor. That means all the acts will be taken in the name of the lieutenant governor in that respect. Okay. Next, the rules of the procedure of the assembly. So the original act basically allowed the legislative assembly to make the rules to regulate the procedure and the conduct of the business in the legislative assembly. Original act, 1991 act. Now this bill, which is basically recently 2021 amended bill, it basically provides that such rules, right, which are made by the legislative assembly, right, to regulate the procedure and the conduct of the business, right, that should be consistent with the rules of the procedure and the conduct of the business in the Lok Sabha. That means it has made, right, that the rules which is basically there in the Legislative Assembly of Delhi should also be consistent with the rules which have been made in the case of Lok Sabha. Okay, then inquiry by the assembly into the administrative decisions. So here the original bill, right, which is there with had certain administrative decisions or certain powers with regard to the inquiry. So here this amendment bill basically prohibits the Legislative Assembly of Delhi from making any rule or, you know, with respect to either itself or any committee, right, to with respect to the day-to-day administration of NCT of Delhi. Okay, so here it basically prohibits the Legislative Assembly from making any rule to conduct any inquiry, right, with respect to the day-to-day administration of the Delhi, right? So it is with respect to, you know, the administrative decisions. Okay, then assent to the bills. So here the act required the lieutenant governor to reserve certain bills which is passed by the legislative assembly for the consideration of the president, as the original bill was required. So once the bill is passed in the legislative assembly, okay, oh, sorry, once there is a decision, when once there is a differences in the opinion between the council of ministers or between the bill which is basically passed by the legislative assembly or of the Lieutenant Governor, then the bill will be referred to the consideration of the President of India. Now, here the bill or the Constitution Amendment Bill basically gave further power to the Lieutenant Governor, right? So it has given certain other power that not only, you know, the Lieutenant Governor can reserve the bill, right? Here, you know, it can also cover the incidentally any matter which is outside the purview of the powers of Legislative Assembly. So it has enhanced the scope of the powers of the Lieutenant Governor that it can reserve any bill, even that matter incidentally cover outside the purview of the Legislative Assembly. Okay, now in the case of the Lieutenant Governor's opinion for the executive actions, so here the act specify basically, you know, that all executive actions which is taken by the government will be taken on the advice of the ministers or otherwise, but that all actions will be taken in the name of the Lieutenant Governor. So that is the simple case that you must understand, that all actions will be taken in the name of the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi, right? And bill basically adds certain other aspects in that it has been provided that the opinion must be obtained before taking any executive action on the decisions of the Council of Ministers or the Minister. So that means it has been bounded the Council of Ministers of Delhi, right, that before taking any executive action, they must have to take the opinion from the Lieutenant Governor. So his opinion is must before taking any option, before taking any action. So that means they have bounded the Council of Ministers of Delhi to seek the opinion from the Lieutenant Governor, right, before proceeding any executive action in Delhi. Okay, so here you can see the Lieutenant Governor, Mr. Anil Baijal, Home Minister Amit Shah, and the Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal. So in short, what you can understand is that the Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi Amendment Bill redefined government as a Lieutenant Governor. That means they gave more primacy to the Lieutenant Governor. Now the government, which is a representative government or representative government, which is basically elected by the people, they have not got any primacy. The Lieutenant Governor has got primacy. So in that respect, the bill redefined the government as a Lieutenant Governor of Delhi, right? Second, the act basically gives the primacy to the Lieutenant Governor over the elected government. That is another task. Okay. And for that purpose, various amendments have been done in the existing provisions of the Government of National Territory of Delhi 1991. Okay, next, the Python 5. See, Python 5 is basically, you know, the news which is coming out is regarding the Python 5, which is basically, you know, air-to-air missile. Okay, so Defense Research and Development Organization have recently conducted a trial of Python 5, which is an air-to-air missile. Now, it has been recently been added to the Tejas, which is basically the India's indigenously light combat aircraft, right, which is basically enhanced its weapon capability. Okay, so regarding Python 5, now you must understand, the Python 5 is basically fifth generation. It is a fifth generation, okay. The air-to-air missile, that is air-to-air missile, that we call air-to-air missile, AAM, right? And it is manufactured by the Rafale. Again, the same Rafale Advanced Defense Systems. Okay, it is manufactured by Rafale Advanced Defense System, and it is basically, you know, the new member which have been added in the Python air-to-air missile. So it is a Python 5, which is a fifth generation. The 5 basically indicate the fifth generation. Okay, now this missile, which is also known as Python 5, can engage the enemy aircraft from very short range, okay, as well as near beyond visual range. So it is something also, you know, having the enhanced capability of engaging, right, the enemy aircraft. Now the Python 5 is also most accurate and most reliable the air-to-air missile, okay, of Israeli Air Force, and it is one of the most sophisticated guided missile in the world that has been existing. Okay, and one more thing is that the Python 5, their development began in 1990s, and now it has been fully developed as a fifth generation Python 5 air-to-air missile. So recently been Tejas, which is India's indigenous light combat aircraft, have added, right, the fifth generation Python 5 into its air weapon capability, right? And this is the news which is basically flashing out, right? So trial for that purpose have already been validated. The enhanced capability of, you know, beyond visual range, you know, the air-to-air missile on the Tejas already been validated. And this test firing, which is conducted at Goa, completes the series of missile trials, which has been also been conducted to check that in the extreme challenging scenarios, what is the performance of this missile. So the Derby missile as well as the Python missiles, right, they have achieved the 100%, you know, the accuracy, and that validate their complete capability as well as their induction in the basically your you know, your Tejas, which is the India's indigenous light combat aircraft. Okay, so the trials met all planned objective, which is basically related with that, you know, combat fighting. Okay, next, the Assam earthquake. As you know that recently the Assam has got the earthquake. So the earthquake was around 6.4 magnitude on the Richter scale. Okay, and it is basically held at the Sonitpur district of Assam. Okay, and after 6.4 magnitude of the earthquake, the Assam has also got six tremors. Okay, that six tremors of the magnitude of 2.7 to 4.2. So these six tremors have got to the different magnitude in the Richter scale. But the higher side, it was 6.4 magnitude initially, the basically the earthquake was, which was recorded. Now, the epicenter for this earthquake was basically has recorded that it was found around 38 kilometers west northwest of the Tejpur at the depth of 11 kilometers, roughly around, you can say, around 80 kilometers from Guwahati. Okay, and the preliminary analysis from the seismologist basically have found that the event or the earthquake has located nearby the Kopili fault, which is closer to the Himalayan frontal fault. Now let us understand the geomorphology of this region, of the Sonitpur region, or roughly in the northeastern region. So first of all, the northeastern region, specifically this Assam region, have been seismically very active, and it has already been introduced or inducted into the highest seismic hazard zone, that is zone 5. So this zone is already been included in the zone 5 or highest hazardous, you know, seismic hazardous zone 5. And it has been associated with the collisional tectonics, where, you know, your two plates, where the Indian plate, you know, ducks behind or beneath your Eurasian plate. So when Indian plate and Eurasian plate collided, right, this type of seismic activities is normally common. And this Himalayan frontal fault, this is also known as the main frontal fault, right, or main frontal thrust, is a basically geological thrust, or is a geological fault which is lying along the boundary of Indian and Eurasian plate. So as I told you that at the time of the movement of Indian plate towards the Eurasian plate, when these two plates collided, this form a fault that is called basically the Himalayan frontal fault or Himalayan frontal thrust, or it is also known as the main frontal thrust. Okay, so it is a geological thrust or fault which is all along the boundary of the Indian plate as well as your Eurasian tectonic plates. Okay, and that Kopili fault that I was talking about, this Kopili fault is basically 300 kilometers the northwest to southeast, right? You can understand the northwest southeast trending fault, which is basically occurred from the Bhutan Himalayas to the Burmese arc. So it is basically moving from the Bhutan Himalayas up to your Burmese, right? So its orientation is basically from northwest to the southwest direction. And regarding the fault definition, so the United States Geological Survey basically defines the fault. The fault means simply a fracture, right, or a tear along the blocks of the crust, right, on the either side that have moved relative to the one another that is parallel to the fracture. Okay, so simply you can understand the fault is basically a fracture. Okay, And what is the possibility of having the earthquake all along this fault? So first of all, you must understand an earthquake can occur on one of these faults, first of all, right? The rocks on the one side of the fault may slip with respect to the another side. So that slippage may cause your earthquakes. And that type of earthquake that occurs because of fault is very, very dangerous. Okay. And the fault surface can be vertical or can be horizontal or some angle to the surface of the earth. And that movement or that relative movement of that fault is basically causes the earthquake. And that is also very dangerous with that respect. Okay. So as I told you that it has been already been included in the seismically hazard zone 5, right? And where the Indian plate basically collided with the Eurasian plate. The point was that the plates, which is basically also called the upper crust, right? It's also called upper crust. Okay. They basically move continuously. Now, these plates, there are 7 major plates. Among them, the one is called Eurasian plate. Okay. Another is called Indo-Austral plate. Right. This plate started moving towards the Eurasian plate. Right. Now, what happens is this movement was started around 200 million years ago. Right. So that movement was started, and that movement basically gave to the Himalayas and various other, you know, fault in the basically in the Himalayan region. So as I told you that this has also led to the main frontal thrust. Right. As I explained you, it is along the boundary of Indian and Eurasian tectonic plates. Right. And this Kopili fault is basically 300 kilometer northwest southeast trending fault, which is also, you know, running from the Bhutan Himalayas to the Burmese arc, which is also the most important aspect of this fault. Okay, now the historical and instrumentally, this earthquake basically recorded as, you know, the region which is affected, right? Almost every year, right? Basically your the earthquakes, right? So here the earthquakes are basically, you know, more oftenly been, you know, occurred in this region. Okay. And in July 1960, the earthquake of the magnitude of 6 was also being reported over there. Okay. So here you can have the epicenter of this earthquake. Okay. Next is Manoj Das. So Manoj Das is basically a poet who has recently been died. Okay. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi have expressed his condolence on the demise of Sri Manoj Das, who was basically the noted educationalist, right? All right. So Manoj Das was basically having died recently because of, you know, some illness. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi basically expressed his the condolence on the demise of Mr. Manoj Das. So Manoj Das was basically an Oriya poet who has also authored many texts, and he was basically born in 1934 and he died in 2021. Okay. And for that purpose, he was basically, you know, well known for his work or for his research in the archives of London as well as in the Edinburgh, right, where he brought some of the light on the little known facts which were related to the Indian freedom struggle, right, that was basically also contributed by Aurobindo, right, and for that purpose, he was also received the first Aurobindo Puraskar, right, in the Kolkata. So he was also known for the putting of the light on certain facts which were little known to the people at that point of the time. Okay. And regarding his awards, so he was awarded many such awards. First of all, in 2000, the Manoj Das was awarded basically the Saraswati Samman. The Saraswati Samman is basically an annual award for outstanding prose or the poetry literacy work. Okay. The Saraswati Samman is basically awarded to any person who have contributed in terms of the prose or the poetry, specifically the literary work in any of the 22 languages, which has been recognized, right, by the Indian Constitution in the 8th schedule of the Constitution of India. Okay, so it has been named, you know, after the Indian goddess of knowledge. As you know, the Indian goddess of knowledge, Saraswati, right? And the Saraswati Samman was instituted in 1991. It was instituted in 1991, basically by K.K. Birla Foundation. Okay, so K.K. Birla Foundation basically have instituted this Samman. Then second, then he was also awarded the Padam Shri in 2001, the Padam Bhushan. Padam Bhushan in 2020 for his contribution in the field of literature and the education. As you already know about the Padam Shri and Padam Bhushan, see, Padam Shri is basically is the fourth highest civilian award. The Padam Shri is basically the fourth highest civilian award. Okay, now it has been you know, the fourth highest civilian award. That means the highest civilian award is basically, all you know, is Bharat Ratna. Okay, then it is the first highest civilian award. The second is basically the Padam Vibhushan. The third is Padam Bhushan. Okay, and the fourth is basically your Padam Shri. So he is awarded the Padam Shri and Padam Bhushan award. Okay, and he was also awarded the Sahitya Akademi Award fellowship, right, by the Sahitya Akademi or by the Kendriya Sahitya Akademi for his outstanding work, right, in that literary tradition, right? So he has basically have awarded different, you know, the diverse award for his great contribution, specifically in the literary as well in the poetry traditions. Okay, next, My Octopus Teacher. Okay, so first of all, it is a documentary, okay, where the 93rd Academy Awards have recognized this 85 minute documentary as the best documentary award, right, this year. So it has been concluded that this 85 minute documentary, which is known as My Octopus Teacher, have been recognized as the best documentary award in the recent time in the 93rd Academy Award, which have been, you know, shown in this documentary a relationship between a human being and a wild octopus. Okay, so here, My Octopus Teacher, okay, which is a name of the documentary, is a basically 2020 Netflix original documentary film. Okay, this film is basically directed by the Pippa Ehrlich and James Reed, right? This documentary shows that a complete year that has been spent by a filmmaker known as Craig Foster, right, gave some sort of a relationship with a wild octopus, specifically in the South African kelp forest, right? So it has shown how the relationship between the humans and the wild octopus have flourished, specifically in the South African kelp forest. So 93 Academy Award basically have won this, have selected this My Octopus Teacher as a best documentary award, as a best documentary feature in this aspect. Okay, regarding the kelp forest, let me give you what are these kelp forest. So you have to listen carefully. See, kelp forests are basically an underwater ecosystem. Okay, which is basically formed in the shallow water, you know, by the dense growth of several different kind of species. So as I told you, it is an underwater ecosystem. That means it basically mainly flourish in the underwater and definitely in the shallow water, where you have the dense growth of several different type of species. That species we call them kelps. So kelps are basically a species that grows in the underwater ecosystem, where the dense growth of these species will be flourished. So if you look like, first of all, they look like almost like a plants, but they are actually extremely large brown algae. You are getting my point? They are not plants. They are extremely large brown algae. And some of the species can reach up to the heights of, say, 150 feet or 45 meter. But that is underwater because it is an underwater ecosystem. All right. And under, you know, ideal physical conditions, they can grow, you know, up to 45 centimeters or 18 centimeters in a single day, right? So their growth is very high. They can reach up to 45 meter, that too underwater I'm talking about, right? And one day their growth can be 45 centimeter if their ideal conditions got, right? And because of their incredible growth, specifically as the underwater ecosystem, right, they can develop very quickly in that areas that they did not, that other ecosystem did not develop in that areas. Okay, so what are the optimum conditions where that this type of kelp or, you know, the algae or extremely large brown algae is developed. So the kelp basically thrives in the cold, nutrient rich water. So they need basically the cold and the nutrient rich water, and the kelps are basically attached to the seafloor, right? So wherever you have the bottom of the sea, so generally they attach with the seafloor, and eventually they grow to the water surface, right? So they are underwater ecosystem, they attach themselves with the seafloor, and then they grow out right towards the seawater or towards the seawater surface. And they rely on the sunlight to generate the food and energy, just like a photosynthesis, right? So the kelp forests are always, you know, they are coastal, and they require the shallow water, and they also require the clear water also, right? So you must also understand that kelps live further from the tropics, right? You know, and the kelp forests do not overlap with those systems like the coral reef, mangrove forest, or seagrass. So the different type of the underwater ecosystem. So as I explained you everything, so kelp forests are basically underwater ecosystem that are basically high dense kelp, which are nothing but, you know, the large brown algae, right, which are normally found in the along the coastlines, specifically in the South African waters, right? And it is recognized as the most productive and the dynamic ecosystem in the world. Okay, and smaller areas which are anchored kelp are basically kelp beds, right? It has basically occurred worldwide throughout the temperate and the polar coastal oceans. It has nothing but the brown algae weeds, seaweeds, but they are not the plants as such. So here you have the documentary which is basically shown by the person called the James Reed, sorry, by the directed by the Pippa Enrich and the James Reed, and the filmmaker Craig Foster basically forging a relationship with wild octopus, specifically in this kelp forest. Okay, next. The Maharashtra two-child norm for the government employees. Now you must understand, the Maharashtra along with certain other states. So we are mainly concerning in this news is Maharashtra. So Maharashtra have made that the person who is going to join the government service in the Maharashtra, he should not have more than two children after 2005. That means they have restricted the person. If the person has more than two children after 2005, he will be dismissed from the service. Right? That has been provided by the Civil Services Declaration of the Small Family Rules, that if a person after 2005, if the person has more than two children, he will be immediately dismissed. Right? So the two children is a norm specifically in the Maharashtra. So recently a woman officer who is working with the Maharashtra Prison Department have been dismissed from the service, right? After the inquiry, which I found that the woman has more than two children. Okay, it is as per the Maharashtra Civil Services Declaration of the Small Family Rules that the woman officer basically suppressed the information from the government that she does not have more than two children, but originally she have more than two children with her. Okay, so as per, you know, the definition of Maharashtra Civil Services Declaration of the Small Family Rules of 2005, the small family include a wife, a husband, and the two children, not more than two children, right? So if the person has more than two children, he is not eligible for a job with the Maharashtra government. Okay, now the Maharashtra is one of the few states where the two child policy still exists, right, for the appointment of the government jobs. They are also exist for the local government bodies also, like panchayat elections. Okay, recently other states like Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Gujarat, Odisha, Uttarakhand, and Assam, they are also followed the similar footsteps which are followed by the Maharashtra to introduce the two child norm for getting the government job with the government of, say, in the respective states. Okay, and this basically set a norm for the small family under the Maharashtra Civil Services Declaration on the Small Family Rules on March 28, 2005, which has made this notification. And the rules basically mandate that while filling the form also for the government job, you have to mandate a small family declaration at the time of filling your government job. And that is mandatory for every, for every service under government of Maharashtra, whether it is group A, group B, group C, or group D, right? The small family norms will be applicable to every group services under the government of Maharashtra. All right. And you must also understand that adopted children are not counted under this rule. That means The definition of the child does not include the adopted children. The adopted children can also have by the people. Okay. Next, Article 217, Clause 1. So first of all, Article 217, Clause 1 basically deals with the appointment of the judge in the High Court. So here recently the news basically fleshing out with respect to the President of India has recently appointed, Srimati Justice Vimla Singh Kapoor as the judge of the Chhattisgarh High Court. She was basically the additional judge of Chhattisgarh High Court, right? Now, she has been recently confirmed as a full judge or as a full-fledged judge of Chhattisgarh High Court with effect from the date she assumed the charge of her office. So, the President of India, in exercising of this power under Article 217, Clause 1, has appointed Srimati Justice Vimla Singh Kapoor from, as a judge of the Chhattisgarh High Court. She was basically holding the additional judge of Chhattisgarh High Court at that point of the time. Okay, so let us understand Article 217. As I have explained you, Article 217 basically deals with the appointment and the conditions of the office of the judges of the High Court. So here you must understand that every judge of a High Court will be appointed by the President. So President has the power for the appointment of the judges of the High Court, not only of the judges of the High Court, but also judges of the Supreme Court also, right? And such judges of the High Court are appointed by the President by warrant under his head and under his hand and the seal. And such appointment will be made by the President of India after consultation with the Chief Justice of India and the Governor of the state, right? So the consultation with the Chief Justice of India and the Governor of the state is basically must. And in the case of the appointment of the judges other than Chief Justice, right, the Chief Justice of High Court, in case of additional or acting judge, right, which also can be appointed under this power, under this act, under this article. But you must understand the highest age for holding the post in the as a High Court judge is basically 62 years, right? So in no case, right, the person can become a judge of a High Court if he is more than 62 years, right? So that means the 62 years is the highest age for being appointed as a judge of your High Court, right? So here, the judge may be by writing his hand addressed to the President, resign his office. So that is, the judge may resign from his office, right, if he has resigned, right, by writing a resignation letter and that has been tendered to the President. And the judge may be removed from his office by the President, right, that is separate, removal process or impeachment process is there with respect to the judges of High Court and the Supreme Court, right, which is being provided under Article 124, Clause 4, which provide the removal process of the judges. They will be removed only along with that process which has been given under Article 124, Clause 4. Okay, and the office of the judge shall be deemed to be vacated if the judge is basically appointed either as a judge of Supreme Court, right? That means he has been elevated from the judge of the High Court to the Supreme Court, or he has been transferred from one High Court to the another court, right? Or you must understand, or he may be removed, right? So in that case, the judge may be, the office of the judge may be vacated, right? So here, either by the transferring or from one High Court to the another High Court, or the elevation of the judge to the Supreme Court, their office of the judge may be vacated. Okay, next, NAVIC. So NAVIC, as you know, is basically the navigation with Indian constellation, right? So here, the National Telecommunications Institute for Policy Research Innovation Training, that is NTIPRIT, which is an apex training institute with the Department of Telecommunication, have recently concluded a webinar, which was conducted on April 28, 2021, right? The topic for this conducting of this webinar is NAVIC opportunities for the telecom industries, with the collaboration of ISRO and telecom industry. That means this webinar basically provided the opportunity which have been brought by the NAVIC, right, which is the navigation with the Indian constellation for the telecom industry. And this webinar is conducted with the collaboration of ISRO and telecom industry. Now, the NAVIC, as you know, I'll give you a brief background of the NAVIC. So NAVIC is basically the navigation with the Indian constellation. It is basically an autonomous regional satellite navigation system which have been established and maintained by the ISRO, right? So first of all, the Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, or IRNSS, it is officially called as NAVIC, Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, IRNSS. It is also known as NAVIC, which is also known as Navigation with Indian Constellation. It is clear. Now, the regional geopositioning system have been designed in India, right, by the ISRO to provide the accurate positioning in India as well as around the Indian mainland. So, according to the ISRO, what you can understand is that IRNSS or Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System was developed for terrestrial, for aerial, for marine navigation, for the disaster management, for vehicle tracking, for the fleet management, right, for integration of the mobile phones also. So that means it has the application for the telecom industry also. It will provide a standard positioning system to all the users, right, to all the common people, and it will also provide the restrictive services, right, that is, you know, the encryptive services for only authorized users, say for the defense industry, for the intelligence purpose, for other secretive purpose, right? So it will be provided for that purpose, right? And the NAVIC is considered as par with the US based, you know, the GPS system, which have been recently been, you know, used in India also. And it has also been as par been developed with, you know, the other satellites or other, you know, the GPS system which have been working. For example, the US based GPS system, the Russia also has their own, you know, the GPS system, for example, Galileo, right? Sorry, GLONASS, right? And the Europe also has their own GPS system, say Galileo, and China has also developed its own GPS system. So that will definitely provide the service and other types of, you know, the telecom related services to Indian telecom industry. So this would cover the India and the region extending up to 1500 kilometers beyond the Indian mainland, right? And it will provide the positioning accuracy that is better than 20 meters, right? And timing accuracy that is 50 nanoseconds, right? And the actual measurement basically demonstrate the accuracy which is better than 5 meter and 20 nanoseconds respectively, right? So you can understand it will provide much greater accuracy than existing the GPS which we are using, okay? And this NAVIC based applications are being used in the various civilian sectors. They started using, including the transport, map application, and timekeepings also. And recently, certain brands also came with the NAVIC features. For NAVIC enabled, the mobile phones are also there in the market. For example, you can purchase the Redmi Note 9 series from Xiaomi, Realme 6 series, OnePlus Nord, right, etc. They have integrated with the NAVIC enabled mobile services. Okay, so where you can easily get these phones from the market. Okay, so the NAVIC, in short, what you can say, it is an indigenous positioning system that are totally under control, and there is no risk of any service which can be withdrawn from any other country. Right now, the India is completely independent of, in terms of having its own indigenous positioning system in India. Okay, next. The Agricultural Infrastructure Fund. Now you must understand, let us understand first of all the news, then we'll move to the brief introduction about Agricultural Infrastructure Fund. See, Agricultural Infrastructure Fund, as per the news, has crossed 8,000 crore mark, right? That means it has received, you know, 8,665 applications worth of 8,216 crore rupees, right? And the largest share pie, which is contributed by the Primary Agricultural Credit Society, that is 58%, agricultural entrepreneurs 24%, and individual farmers 13%. Now, let us understand first the Agriculture Infrastructure Fund, then you would probably able to, you know, appreciate what is that Primary Agricultural Credit Society, Agri Entrepreneurs, and individual farmers. So first of all, the Union Cabinet basically approved this, the central sector scheme, which is known as Agriculture Infrastructure Fund. So it is a central sector scheme. Okay, the main purpose of this Agriculture Infrastructure Fund to inject the formal credit into the farm and the farm processing based activities, right? So as you know that it's because of the Corona or COVID-19 crisis, right? The government want to cover, right? Government want that part of over 20 lakh crore stimulus package will be announced, right, by the government of India specifically for the agriculture purpose. Okay, and the main aim of this Agriculture Infrastructure Fund is to provide the medium and the long-term debt financing facility, the medium to long-term debt financing facility for the investment in the viable projects for, let's say, for post-harvest management infrastructure or for the community farming assets. For that purpose, a debt financing facility will be provided through this agriculture infrastructure fund. That is the first prime objective, right? And that purpose from this fund, right, the debt will be provided, for setting up of this cold storage plants, for the cold chains plants, for the warehouses, for the silos, for assaying, for grading and packaging units, right, for e-marketing points, right, which is linked with the e-trading platforms, right, the ripening chambers, different type of PPP, other infrastructure projects will be financed through this agriculture infrastructure fund. I hope it is clear. And the time period for which this agriculture infrastructure fund would be run from 2020 to 2029. That means almost 10 years from this fund, the money will be provided. All right. Now, here the primary agricultural credit society, first of all, you must understand, it is basically a basic unit and the smallest cooperative credit institution in India. It is the smallest cooperative credit institution in India, and it definitely works under the grassroots level. Okay. Now, as I told you that the Agriculture Infrastructure Fund is a medium to long-term debt financing facilities, right, that will be provided to the viable projects, let's say for the post-harvest management infrastructure, community farming asset. Just now I've explained you, right, that for example, for setting up of this cold chains, cold storage chains, warehouses, silos, packaging, right, and e-marketing points, e-trading platforms, chambers, right, the different type of infrastructure projects will be done. As I told you that it is basically run for the 10 years, that means from 2020 to 2029. So here 1 lakh crore will be provided by the banks, right, as well as the financial institution as a loan, right, as well as there will be interest subvention facilities like 3% per annum will also be provided. And here the credit guarantee, which will be also covered for the loans for the 2 crores rupees, right? And eligible beneficiary under this basically are farmers, farmers producers organization, PACs, marketing cooperative societies, self-help groups, joint liability groups, multi-purpose cooperative society, agri entrepreneurs, startups, central state agency for the local body sponsored public-private partnership project. So these all beneficiaries will be eligible to get the finance under this central sector scheme. Okay, next, the Morarji Desai National Institute of the Yoga. See, Morarji Desai National Institute of Yoga, first of all, is located in New Delhi. Okay, now it is a national institute which is under the Ayush Ministry or Ministry of Ayush, is offering the online yoga training programs. Okay, the main purpose of this online yoga training program is to promote the health and to relieve the anxiety among the people. Okay, so the Morarji Desai National Institute of Yoga is an autonomous institution fully funded by the Ministry of Ayush, Government of India. It is currently located in New Delhi. Okay, it basically promotes the deeper understanding of the yoga philosophy and practices which is based on the classical yoga among the people, especially among the youths. Okay, and it's basically focused for the planning, training, promotion and the coordination of yoga education, the yoga training, the yoga therapy, yoga research in all aspects. Okay, the institute was basically started in 1970 in the form of hospital, and slowly it has basically developed as a full-fledged institute, right? With all sort of Indian system of medicines, right, under the Vishwanathan Yogashram, right? And in 1998 the institute was further renamed as the Morarji Desai International Institute of Yoga for expanded mandate for providing the online, the yoga education as well as offline yoga education also. But nowadays the COVID related pandemic has forced us to, to basically adopt this online, the yoga philosophy or yoga training or yoga education or yoga therapy, right, which is also being provided by this Morarji Desai, the National Institute of Yoga. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you very much. Take care of yourself.